Right. Good morning, everybody. The launcher, Oshani, Sanjeev, and we have three, right? So good morning to you all. Hope you have a nice weekend. So today that we are going to start investment tools in project financing. So basically, during today's discussion, what I am trying to, you know, impart the knowledge on investment tools in like project appraisal. Good morning, Sanjeev. Good morning, Oshani. Basically, that's to, you know, get an idea, you know, how we are going to, let's say, take our investment decision. I mean, last week I just mentioned like when we undertake financing, like ratio analysis and all that. So that is basically to get an idea about how we undertake, how we are going to conduct. Get an idea or decision about financing decision. So before moving to the financing decision, we need to know whether it's an investment feasible or not. Let's say I have like 100 million with me. I'm planning to invest in a couple of projects. So first of all, I should know whether these projects give me a kind of investment return that I am expecting. Good morning, Dilanja. It's like this, like let's say, if I am not doing anything, I can put this into what you call in treasury bill, treasury bonds in a bank. So I get 4%, 5%, 6%. But if I want to get, say, my return on investment is my required rate of return, say 10%, then I need to see what are those investment opportunities out there, me to invest on those projects. So that's what I am targeting. So if in case that if whatever the, you know, projects gives me highest return as against my required rate of return, probably I might say, you know, this is the project that I am going to take, right? I am going to invest. So like that, there may be a couple of investment tools available to take that kind of a decision. So today's discussion will be, you know, to get familiarized those investment tools and further familiarize how we are going to, you know, conduct kind of, you know, analysis in a given scenario, right? So I have shared two documents. That is a one presentation. The other one is like a reading material, right? So that's about, you know, leisurely you can read what is payback kind of NPV and all that, because which is most important areas in these investment tools. And the presentation, basically, we will, you know, start with like a kind of some learning objectives and bit of initial into the nature and importance of the project financing, and then we will move to the investment tools as just discussed. So the learning objectives for today could be understand nature importance of investment decision making in an organization, because why that we need to, you know, make this kind of investment decision, and what's the like rationale of, you know, taking this investment decision, and why, what's the like, you know, the nature of these investment decisions, and what's the like importance of this investment decision. That's what initially that we are planning to discuss. Then project financing, earlier we also have been you know, discussed, we have discussed this, but again as a recap, we'll see what is the project financing definition kind of thing. Then what is time value, right? How we compute the discounting factors, which is coming under NPV calculation, which we are going to learn today. Then four investment appraisal methods, and based on that, how we are going to compute a kind of example, and then get further familiarized on these investment tools, because these things are in most of the times in question four in our past papers. Then advantages, disadvantages of this each investment tools against the other. So because that is again important for us in case, you know, for example purposes. Finally, based on the, you know, the investment outcome, investment calculation, so what's our recommendation, which investment tools gives the, you know, best, and based on several criteria, what is our decision on selecting the particular investment. That's what we are planning to discuss today. Then nature importance, right? So this is all about projects, in a project, why that we need to take that important decisions called investment decision. Because not like the decisions like, you know, maybe purchasing some machine, you know, investing in some working capital, could be introducing a kind of product line. So those things in terms of existing business may not be a major decision for an entrepreneur, for a big businessman. But let's say starting an apartment project, starting a rice milling factory, starting a steel factory, starting a hotel. So maybe a kind of important and bit of complex decision. So you can just understand about the micro decision versus the major decision in the case of a business organization. So the latter that I discussed is are important, and also it has kind of, you know, nature which is in line with project financing, right? So what's the nature of these type of projects are long term versus short term, right? Generally, let's say you invest and you return, maybe outcome results may not be short term. Like investing in kind of working capital is not a long term investment, because in 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, you get the money back and you reinvest. But in case of a hotel, maybe first 2 years, it's a grace period where you are not supposed to get any repayment of your capital in terms of a loan. Even in the business also, it'll take 1 to 1.5 years time to make the break even. Then after 5 years, 6 years, 7 years only that you are getting kind of adequate income which you have expected. So in the nature of these projects are long term, short. Investment perspective, large versus small, 1 million, 2 million, 5 million, 10, 15 million as against 100, 200, 500, 1 billion, 2 billion kind of investment. So in terms of investment also, amount involved is big. So it tells you the kind of, you know, the criticality of the kind of a decision that you need to take. Complicated from concerns of future cash flows and the time value. Another two concerns, because now the projects generally, you know, we are dependent on future cash flows. Right now they're not generating anything, because it's a, like what you call, it's a something about a blank paper. It's startup, right? We are not getting anything right now, but future only, the, with the project going to successful, get you money. So future cash flows, you, there are a lot of things that it could be, you know, future cash flows be dependent. Last week we learned about project feasibility. So out of those, everything's combined result could be a successful future cash flows. Then time value of money, later also we are trying to learn, it's something, you know, the value of 1 rupee is different from today to tomorrow, or today to 1 year's time. Obviously that, you know what it means. Like, let's, if I have 1 million today, the things I can do, it's not similar, the same 1 million I'm getting it 3 years time. So that's what say, there's a value for money. It's basically time dependent. So these four are, tells you the nature of this investment decision. Then we move to the importance of this investment decision, because large amount of resources involved in terms of, say, business strategy, profitability, survival. So those are the words that we will, you know, talk. Those are the words which we will be, you know, concerned with. Like, not like, you know, having another product, having another working capital investment, having another machine. So are not very, you know, great, I mean, say. I mean, not a large amount of resources are involved in these decisions. But in terms of a factory, like a tire factory recently opened in Horan, or maybe some garment factory, or maybe a fishing harbor. So those are, you know, large resources are involved. And, you know, the outcome is basically, is critical for business strategy or profitability, even the survival, right? If you're not going to do that, so you might not be in this business for next 3 to 5 years, because it's a must, right? Hence that you put a lot of resources. So failure means that, you know, you are end of the road like that. So that is the importance that we are talking about. Difficult to bail out once an investment made, like, not like, you know, other. So once you are trying to do this, So even the feasibility level, initial level, if you do kind of some investment, so it's big, it's huge. Take project financing proposition in terms of apartment, right? Let's say if you do, you know, land preparation, piling, and soil testing kind of thing. Say after some time, let's say due to whatever the reason, you are not in a position to complete or move forward with the apartment project. So what has happened now? So you have done a good investment on the project in terms of piling and all that. Now, other than apartment, now you can't use that, you know, soil or that piece of land for some other projects, because the piling has been done in terms of to take the you know, the weight and all that of our 10-15 story building. Now you can't put it to some other purpose. You getting my point? Because the investment is now is big, so you can't bail it out because it is now sunk. So you need to keep that in also in mind. That is means it's important decision that you need to take. Close relation with shareholders, because these investments are the money, resource, people, and all that are big, huge. So ultimately, this is not only the profit. So profit come to net worth like wealth maximization, right? So ultimately, if you do this, it's a 5 billion project, a 10 billion project. Ultimately, it comes to the balance sheet of the firm, and so it you know, supports a net worth or profit, net worth, and overall wealth of the shareholders. So these are the things that, you know, you need to keep in mind in terms of exam also. Why projects are important? What's the nature of the project? Because then they talk about, you know, write a short note on project financing. What is project, right? Why the projects are important for investors? What's the nature, right? What are the features of a project? So in that sort of question, you need to answer using this type of you know, the ingredients. Hope this is you know, understood, but if anything, please let me know. Right, next one, we try to understand about what is project financing. That's just again to understand about some definitions. I think this is again important. Sometimes they ask about a short note on project financing features kind of thing. So you can take some points here and you can complete your answer. Here, long-term financing of infrastructure and industrial projects based upon the projected cash flows of the project than balance sheet of the project sponsors. So basically, so project financing can be defined. It's kind of long-term financing, infrastructure, industrial projects, but most importantly, based upon the projected cash flows than the balance sheet, right? Now, if you take some other cases, we talk about balance sheet. The strength of the balance sheet, you know, tells you you can go ahead and do a project. But in terms of project financing, not the balance sheet is important. It's the future ability of the project to generate cash flows, because that tells you how possible, you know, how confident the project loans could be serviced, right? So that's basically the point number one. Number two involves number of equity investors, their sponsors, or maybe a couple of banks. It could be one bank or syndication of bank, right? So in terms of project financing could be done by two parties, sponsors, project owners, and the banks or the lending organization, right? It could be one, it could be couple. Instead of similarly, maybe investors, one or many. Third, non-recourse, which are secured by the project assets and paid entirely from the project cash flows, as I mentioned above, than balance sheet or the creditworthiness. Decision is part supported by financial modeling. So a couple of words there again. Because non-recourse, it means, so once you like, you know, invest, so it's difficult to recourse. If you done, it's finished because it become a sunk cost. So then it's like, you know, a do or die kind of thing. So you need to take a very good decision before investing, before financing. So that's why we are trying to learn about these investment tools. And secured against project assets like land, building, machinery, project contracts, and everything will be a part of a security. Right? Non-recourse, secured. And supported by financial modeling means, now it's not easy to tell you that, you know, the future, you know, the cash flows, they are to service your debt. In order to see the strength of the future cash flows, timing of the future cash flows, some variations of the future cash flows, and all those things could be supported using this financial modeling. It could be sensitivity analysis, scenario analysis. There are so many, you know, the tools that you can, like simulation models sort of thing, can be used to ascertain the future cash flows, status of the future cash flows. That's why I say supported by financial modeling. A forecasted financial statement is one of them. Because now, today, you can't tell how well that, you know, the project will generate cash. So in order to do that, in order to forecast or that, you need financial modeling. Fourth one, again, telling secured against project assets. The last one, lenders are given lien on all these assets, able to assume control of the project if the project company has difficulties complying with the loan term. It means now generally as project lenders, so you have a control, right? In case if the project owners are failed to meet obligation, difficulty to meet obligation, then it's your baby. So you need to run and, you know, get the things going and generate cash flows to repay. I mean, means that you need to find some kind of support. If this part is not going to, then you need to find another good part to run this, right? That's because otherwise, not like general loans, if the project going bad, means it's a huge impact to your balance sheet, similar like promoters. So that's why we say we have a lien, we have a control, right? So that's why we are putting so many terms and conditions in order to manage the project. So these are the things that, you know, that we need to know about project financing, about a brief description of the project, and in case of we are supposed to write a kind of a short note, so you can take some of these inputs and prepare your answer. Right. Before moving to that, any questions on project financing and its like features and the nature and the importance? Anything? Right. Any question? Hope it's not a big, difficult area in the initial part. So this is basically the important part right now we are trying to understand. Right. Here, now we have four methods of investment appraisal. Right. Payback, ARR, NPV, IRR. So the payback is basically time taken to recover your initial capital expenditure, or rather we can say time taken to recover the capital investment in a project. That way it's also correct, because sometimes not only the initial capital, there may be a subsequent capital also being introduced into the projects. So in that sense, it is like important to, you know, get the definition, say time taken to recover the capital investment. That's number one. So no worries that, because we are trying to, you know, do this through a kind of illustration, so that you get a better idea once we are trying to do this computation, right? Then number two, accounting rate of return is a return measurement by using the average annual profits. Like, now let's say you are engaged in a kind of a project, and the project generates some cash flows in terms that you can get some profitability out of that. And you try to compare your profits as against the investment. We call ARR, profit versus the investment. That's a ratio that you are giving, you are getting. NPV is, you know, the present value of future cash flows. That's a net present value technique, where you have some cash outflows, you have some cash inflows, and then you have to see what is the today's value of the future cash flows. Year one, year two, year three, year four, yes, we are generating cash flows. But in this scenario, we are trying to see the value of today of those cash flows. That concept is we call net present value. Fourth one, internal rate of return is, again, it's a kind of interest rate. We are taking time value of cash flows. So those are the four investment appraisal tools in brief that we are trying to learn today. So what we are trying to do here is we take a kind of, you know, the illustration, and through illustration, we'll try to learn each and every concept. Okay. Right. Here, example, two projects that your company has to choose. However, you can only choose one of them. The data initial investments are the following table. You are required to calculate payback, ARR, NPV, IRR, and your recommendation. So that's what our target task. Right. Here we have project A, project B. Initial investment for project A is 100,000. Project B is again 100,000. Cash flows year one, 45, 40, 35, 30. And project B, we have cash flows 30, 30, 44, 46. Right. Depreciation, 20,000 per year. Residual value or scrap value is 20,000, which is happening at year four. Right. So this is the kind of a question. Before moving to the, you know, the requirement, we will try to understand some terminologies here. Here we have project A, we have project B. Initial investment means you try to undertake these two projects having a sum of 100,000 with you. That's initial investment. Once you invest this 100,000, each project would give back cash flows at the end of year one, two, three, four. This is the kind of, you know, the project A report, project B report. So as a promoter, as a sponsor, now we need to know which project is good for me in terms of payback, ARR, IRR, NPV. So initially we are trying to use the payback. Then further down, depreciation 20,000 per year, which is an uncash flow. But each year, there is a depreciation provision of 20,000. If you are computing profit, you need the depreciation. But if you are computing cash flows, you need not the depreciation. Just remember. Last point, both projects, the initial investment could be realized after project life in year four, amounting to 20,000. Means that you invest today, and after 4 years, whatever the investment in terms of machine, in terms of whatever, so that can be realized into a cash flow, which is 20,000. It's an inflow again, in addition to annual cash flows. So that is basically project data. Now we are supposed to compute payback, IRR, so on and so forth. So start with payback. So what is payback now? Payback has been defined as time taken to recover initial capital or project capital. What it means? What is our initial capital? 100,000. So at which point we are recovering the 100,000 is now we need to know. At which point? So you need to compute for project A. You need to compute for project B. So what is your decision then? The time taken to recover your capital is say X in terms of project A, project B we say Y. I mean, lower the period you prefer, no? Because you put 100,000 today and one project will give you in 2 years, the other project give the money in 3 years. So lower the time taken to recover the initial capital, you say it's good for me. So I am going to select project A because it gives me my investment back in 2 years as against project B. So that's what we need to establish, right? Okay. So this is the kind of, you know, the illustration. So we have to project A, we have cash flows, we have cumulative cash flows, third column, right? So based on that, we need to find the payback period. A clue here is payback period is where a point in time at which cash flows turn from negative to positive. Negative in positive in a velava tamai, apikiana menna payback ek. Harini. Going by the cumulative cash flows, what is mean negative to positive? Because you have initially 100,000 going out and year one onwards you are getting some money. You're trying to find a point where, at which point, where my capital 100,000 is going to equal with negative and this should be positive. So the point is obviously cash flows turn from negative to positive. So if you are able to find that, means it's your payback period, right? Take some time and see whether you can compute that. And then we will discuss in on the board, right? This is how the computation. What you need to do is you have to have project A, then cash flows for each year, and cumulative cash flow will be the final column. Using the cumulative cash flow column, we try to find a point where the cash flows turn from negative to positive. So when we know that, then we know it is the payback period, right? Let me know what is the payback period. Give a try and you know, have your feedback. Dilanja, Oshani and Sanjeev. Yeah, only three of you today. What is the possible answer? If you do have any queries, please let me know, right? So I know. Dilanji, you got the concept correct? Sanjeev? Oshani, you got the concept? Explanation is clear? Oh. Okay, thanks, Dilanji. And Sanjeev and Oshani? Thanks, Sanjeev. Okay, very good. So let's see. whether we can, you know, do a kind of computation. Once you do it, please tell me or share through chat. If not, we can go to the board and explain it further. Mipara, they haven't asked about payback, only NPV question was there. So probably there may be a question for us next time on payback. Okay, Davi. Project A 24285, right? Sanjeev, then you can do with the project B also. Dilanj, Oshani, what about you? Ogolana te uttare aavada or it's a closer? What was the answer you get? Point? Yeah. See what you answer. Right, thanks, Oshani. What about Dilanj? What are they called? Do we need to do it? Very good. So you have done it spot on. Great. So we'll move to the next one also, and then project B, we'll see thereafter the answers. Just do it for the project B and see which project is good in terms of payback. What could be the answer? Project B. Dancing 2.909 Oshani, yes, Sanjeev, Dilanj, yes, so means project A is better than project B, yes, good decision, Oshani. Now, if you see the answers, right, and here payback A. Is change in cash flow required to reach zero total cash flow in year? It's like mean negative to positive. That is 15,000 divided by 35,000. I'll show why it has been taken like that here. If you see this, so in year zero, it's negative 100,000. That's going out. Year one, you get a 45 in. So the cumulative is minus 55, year 2 minus 15, year 3 plus 20, year 4 plus 70. Why this means, sorry, why this 50? Because in year 4, normal cash flows is 30 plus scrap value has been added here. So because it's another cash inflow. Scrap value, disposal value, that has to be a inflow added back to the cash flow. 30 has become to 50. So then this is the cumulative cash flows. At year 0, you have minus 100. Year 1, you have minus 55. Year 2, 15 minus. Year 3, plus 20. Means this 15,000 is within this 35,000. That's what generally means. So this 50,000 has to be recovered using this 35,000. Ekai, methanda gihilla, 55 divided by 35,000 aave. So 2.43 years is the answer. So sometimes, you know, some past papers we can see, this is given in years, like they are not going to go do the and computation to the fractions, but just say 3 years. But in this case, we, you know, have gone into the decimals because it's both are happening in year 3. So good to know that what is exactly the decimal places, so then we can get an answer. When come to the project B, it is 0.91 plus 2, that's 2.91 years. If you get here, project B, minus 100, minus 70, minus 40, plus 4. So this 40,000 is within this 44,000. There are 40 divided by 44 tamai fraction. This is the negative that we need to, deficit that we need to recover. And what is the relevant cash flow? 44,000 tamai is a relevant available cash flow. 40 divided by 44. Here again, 66 aave, 46 plus 20 methenta advechi nisa. Right. So then sometimes we might see some interim cash flows or interim cash outflows. Now here initially 100 going out, end of the project end of the year 4, again cash inflow as a disposal value. But let's say in year 2, another 50,000 going out. So you need to treat that here, year 2. In addition to 30,000 coming in, 50 going out. So it's a minus 20 here. So then again, 70 will be become 90 here. So that's how you treat interim cash flows. If going out, cash interim cash outflows are there because it could be capex or related, that has to be treated accordingly. Here, initially going out at end of the project, end of the fourth year, it's a coming in. But there may be a question where interim, they say there is another cash outflow. And then you the net cash flow cumulative cash flow. Hope that you have got it. Any questions on that? Any questions? Interim cash flows ideally you can do the computation for years, just say 3 years, 2 years, 4 years, but we better do for the decimal here because there are the cash flows are realized in year 3, so that in order to make a difference we compute it for decimals, right? Yes, and that carter ek karanna puluwan 2 plus how many months can that pull on? So that, decimals into number of months calculate karama, you can get it in number of months also. 2 months plus 4 months. 2 years plus four, or maybe five. Ilange ke samal lavata, 2 years plus 11 months ke levi. No harm. Either way you can calculate, but depending on the question that we will decide whether we are going to compute for decimal or just we'll get the number of years, right? Finally, if there is an interim cash outflow, Sanjeev, second year example, if you take in the second year, what happened is, question, way back. Let's say year two, year 40,000 is the, now if you take in year 2, you have 40,000, 30,000 respectively. Suppose we have year 2, we have another 20,000 cash outflow, right? So here it is positive 40 minus 20. Then what's the net cash flow here? What could be net cash flow here then? So 20,000 cash outflow, na meta net cash flow ki yada venne one. Sanjeev, how much then? 40 or 20?
20,000.
20, right? Because 20,000 going out as a cash outflow, then the net cash flow here is 20. No changes on the others. So then what happened here? Instead of 15, what could be the answer here? Then we have 20, you know.
35.
Minus, yeah. 35. Then go to the 35, then answer here is 0.
0, yeah.
Then what is the payback? Exactly 3 years.
3 years, yes.
That's what tell. So okay. Then the payback has been extended. The only thing you have to do is each year you try to come up with the net cash flow. In net cash flow, you need to find what is cash in, what is cash out. There may be interim cash outflows also. Cash flow for each year, what is going out, coming in. Then you go to the cumulative cash flow. Cumulative cash flow, the point where negative becomes positive will be your payback period. There are some, you know, questions to that effect. So Sanjeev, like, you know, generally what you could do here is, now rather than you know, taking it year 2, you can bring it to year 1 also. Like say here, if it is a 20,000, what it means is, so total outflow is like 120 kilogram. So you see where the 120 is recovering. So it's something 45, 40 and 35. Year 3 kilogram. So it's correct. Like, now, once you are very much familiar on this exercise, need not to do this kind of cumulative cash flow kind of thing. Say, what is outflow? 100, year 0, year 2, another 20, because time value we are not taking here. 100 going out, 20 going out, 120 is my going out. What is coming in? 45, 40, 35. 45 plus 40, 85. 80 plus 35, 120. Means 3 years is my break even, sorry, payback. So you can do that sort of calculations also. Like, I'm not even encouraging to do that, but whenever you are so much comfortable, so that's a method. Each year, you know, total out is anyway, whether it is today, tomorrow, year 2, year 3, indifferent. Why? We are not taking time value concepts. Okkoma cash flow adahambuna thetahambuna. Year 3 will happen, they are taking as today. Because no time value concepts still come in here. Just take what's out, what is in, and you try to see where my cash out is equal, or I mean negative is coming to 0. Year 1, the year 2, the year 3, the year 4. That's it. Got it? Any
questions?
Yeah. Dilanja, Oshani, you are done with? All good? Any difficulty? Good. Right. Let's move to next one. That is ARR. Right. That's another concept. Accounting rate of return. This is the step 1, 2, 3, 4. Now I again invite you to do the computation and see whether what is the ARR for project A and project B. This is the steps. You can say annual profit. Instead of net cash flow, you can say cash inflow minus depreciation. That's very much fine, because otherwise we might get complex here. Yeah, on that. So here we take cash flow minus depreciation. You can, you know, amend your equation, annual profit is equal to cash inflow per particular year minus depreciation per particular year. So like that, you can compute the annual profit. Average profit is, you know, total profit divided by number of years. Then average capital investment is initial cost and the residual value. Remember, residual value and initial cost are taken for the average capital investment. And then ARR is average profit, that's step two divided by step three. Right, take 5 minutes and do the computation. See what's our ARR. Right, you need the question again? මේක මෙහෙම දැම්මොත් ඔයගලන්ට ඒක පේන්නේ නැද්ද කොහමද සංජීව if I put this ARR slide do you need to get the data on the question or do you have it or can you see it
better if question was there
okay then first get an idea on this step 1 step 2 step 3 step 4 liya gannu ko because when I go to that you might know. Oh otherwise I can show this is the question first you get this write it down initial investment 1 2 3 4 depreciation 20 residual is 20,000 once you get the information written down I'll move to the steps. Project A, Project B, liya ganne ka. Cash inflows year 1, year 2, year 3, year 4, 45, 40, 35, 30, 30, 30, 44, 46. Depreciation is 20. Residual value, both projects 20,000. Once you get this one, I'll move to the other one. If anything, please let me know. So I'll again go back here. Right, this is the ARR equations. Now try to do the ARR. If any issue, let me know, please. What could be your answer? Roshani, Vilanja, were you able to make it? Atamaru. What is the answer? Oshani, that is like initial investment is 100,000. Need to consider for step two. If you see the step two here, sorry, step three, average investment is initial cost plus residual value. So initial cost is the initial investment, which is 100,000. So that is coming as the investment component. Sanjeev, yeah, you have got 29%. That is for project A. Project B, you can compute current. What about Dilan Jawagumad? Sanjeev, you can proceed with the project B and come up with what is the best project in terms of ARR based on that answer. What are the answers? Yeah, same. Dilanja, same. Oshani, what about you? Were you able to compute? Fourth year annual profit should be 30,000. Yes, yes. Fourth year it's 30. So just hold on. Fourth year annual profit in the sense, you have to see cash flow minus depreciation, but make sure you are not taking the residual value into the cash flow, Oshani. So that's why you come up with that answer, I suppose, because it is being considered for investment. Residual value ekai, initial investment ekai, capital investment ekata vitarai api use karala tiyenne. Rest will be taken for annual cash flow minus depreciation. Ehema gattot year 4 eke project A, year 4 we have only 30,000 minus depreciation 20, so the profit is 10,000. Profit is 10,000. I'll show it if it, you have any issue on that. Shall we see the answer so that you can understand? Right. Right. This is the project A and project B. So project A average profit is 25, 20, 15, 10. So 70,000 is the total profit divided by 4 is 17,500. How this has come is basically, so in each year we have taken cash inflow minus depreciation. If you take for year 1, 45,000 minus 20 is a depreciation 25. Year 2, 40 minus 20. Year 3, 35 minus 15. Year 4, 30 minus 20. So that's why 10, 15, 20, 25, cumulative 70 divided by 4, 17,500. When come to the invested average is 100,000 is the initial investment and 20,000 is the residual, because now it is coming as an investment now. Investment return. Kattita ena nisa thamai e investment ekata thamai eka api consider karanne. So 100 plus 20 divided by 2, 60. Then average profit is 17,500 divided by average investment is 60, then you get the answer of 29. That is project A. You need to replicate the same for project B. Aka annual cash flow minus annual depreciation. Annual cash flow minus annual depreciation. But we are not touching initial investment or scrap value. Why we are not touching is basically it is being taken care of under this average capital investment. So 100,000 plus 20 divided by 12, 68th and average, make it 17,500. So answer 29. So as per ARR, which is a disadvantage here also, we are now unable to tell which project is now good, because both gives the same ARR, right? So depending on the project size, right, maybe very high project or very low project, you might get the same ARR, right? Because it's a division of two numbers, it's a percentage. So both ends up with same ARR. So unable to comment, unable to choose based on the ARR, right? So now since that Sanjeev and Dilanji have done it correctly, Oshani, how about you? Please let me know whether you have got it. Okay, very good, right. Thank you. So means that we have not, you know, got many questions using ARR, but except one under MCQ. So be very careful. In ARR, we are dealing with profits. Rest of the investment tools, we are dealing with cash flows. When you are dealing with the profits, we need to make sure cash flows has to be converted to profit. Depreciation figure. Rest of the cases, depreciation is a non-cash flow. Non-cash flow depreciation in all other scenarios. ඒක තමයි පළවෙනි tip එක. Number 2, you need not to take investment numbers into profit. එතකොට profit කියලා කියන්නේ annual profit is something inflow minus outflow. Outflow is only the depreciation here. හරිද? එතකොට හැම වෙලේම particular year there may be cash inflow and outflow as a form of depreciation. එතකොට අපි ගත්තා එතනදී annual profit like how many years you cumulative divide by number of years average profit එක compute කරා. Average investment is something initial investment and scrap or disposal value and get it average it. So divide by 2 in general. So the quota there may be complexities also if in the case of interim cash flows what we are going to do kind of thing. But you know, so in that sense like you have to take it like you know whatever maybe total investments and add up divide by 2. That's what we generally do because we can't divide by 3 because we are not taking any time value. We presume it's something you know initial and you know end. So just divide by 2. Let's say interim cash flows or something. Again, you take that into account and again divide by 2, not by 3 or 4. Maybe interim cash inflows or outflows could be also there. You know, like the previous example I introduced with another 20,000 incoming in year 2. So like that, if there is, I mean, just get all the you know the investments like cash outflows. You know. Add up together, divide by 2, just to get average. That's it. That's how the investment average we are getting. Then, අපි මොකද කරන්නේ? Annual profit එක average investment එකෙන් බෙදලා, see what's the percentage. So, higher the percentage is your decision. But here, ratios or the percentages are same, so you are unable to comment, which is good. That itself a disadvantage of ARR. Fine. So, if it is clear. So we'll move to the NPV. Any questions? I don't think you might be able to grasp that. And if not, we'll move. If anything, please let me know. Right. Then time value of money, which is important part, right? So first we'll go through this, and then we will again do a kind of a question, right? Right, time value of money is basically as a concepts. As I was telling at the beginning, maybe realization of you know money today versus tomorrow could be different. Or having money today versus end of next year is could be different. Why? There may be so many reasons. Underline that, which is in the point 2. The factors would change the value of money. What are those factors? Interest cost, first one. Because if the interest rates are zero, then you're not getting anything from today to next year in terms of interest. But it is not. There may be average interest rates like savings rate, FD rates, so maybe 5%, 6%, 7% means if you're 100 today and put it to the bank, after 1 year you get 106. If you are doing nothing, 100, and after 1 year you get 100 because if you are not investing. But because of this interest rate, then there may be some difference between today versus next year. Then inflation also, it also come in and play a kind of vital role in deciding the value of money. ඒක නෑ අපි කියන්නේ අද රුපියල් 1000කට ගන්න තිබ්බ එකක් තව අවුරුද්දකින් 1000කට ගන්න අපිට බැරි වෙනවා. So that's due to inflation. අපි එහෙමයි කියන්නේ. Because that also could contribute your purchasing power in other terms. ඒක අපි තේරෙන භාෂාවෙන් කියනවා. Right? Disposable income. In a further word. So that all, you know, happening due to this inflationary impact. So inflation, interest cost, other risk to materialize the money. Right, not if like it's good that if you get money today, after 1 year that you are getting promotion and you get some money, it's remote, right? If your boss is going moon away, then probably you might not get that promotion. So mean there are maybe other risk also. It could be environmental, man-made or whatever, right? So there may be a chance that, you know, a realization of money. So like the things that, you know, nobody would have expected, the COVID-19. So probably you might have, you know, expectations, but you were not, you know, able to get everything materialized because this, you know, sudden impact. So like that, there may be other risk also. So based on this, value of money could be changed over time. So that is what is time value concepts coming into the operation. In a project angle, like if you invest 100,000 today, which is a cash outflow, year one, year two, year three, year four, you are getting cash in, and end of year four that you are getting disposal value, scrap value also. But in payback, you just add up and see when I am recovering my 100,000. But when it comes to the time value, you can't do that because year four, 30,000 is not similar year one, I mean year zero, 30,000. It could be 27,000. Right? Maybe year four scrap value of 20,000, it could be again 18,000 today. So the quota, you have to bring that into today's value. Right. Why? Because of these factors. Right. Then there's another, you know, a computation we can do. Annual interest rate is 10,000. I lend you £1 now. We'll get back after 1 year. How much worth of that £1 in a year's time is based on this equation? So like future value into 1 plus 10% is equal to £1. So that is 0.91. In other terms, if I have 100 rupees today, and if I can invest that 100 rupees in the 10% in some kind of instrument, and after 1 year, the value of 100,000 could be 91. Means, let's say if somebody is asking, I will give 100,000 in 1 year's time. So today's value of that 100,000 is 91. That's more explainable, understandable, right? So instead of giving 100,000 today, if he is telling you, I'll give it in 1 year's time, then that 100,000 is valuable only 91 rupees for me. Hope you are getting that, right? So that's a time value. Means if I have 100,000, if I have 100 rupees today, and then if I want to do the same job done, I mean, that 100,000, whatever, 100 rupees worth work to be done in after 1 year's time. So I need to have not 100, 100 plus another 10%. That's 110%, 110. That's why if you say accumulative purpose, right? That is the one way to look into. If not, the other way is something where if you give 100 rupees after 1 year, I must tell the value of the 100 rupees in 1 year is only 91 rupees for me if I see in today's context. I think you get what I mean, the time value concept, right? So either way you can consider, it's like, say, if you say today's 100 and in order to do the same work in after 1 year, I need to have not only 100, I need to have something more than that. That is 110 because of this 10% here. if you see, in other words, in order to see that, you know, the impact of the 100 rupees I am getting in 1 year's time. So if you promise me to say that I'll be given 100 in after 1 year instead today, but I'll tell you the value of the 100 after 1 year's, for me in today's context, it's not 100, it is 91. ඒකට වඩා අඩුයි. අපිට පුළුවන් පොසිටිව් පැත්තෙන් බලන්නත් නෙගටිව් පැත්තෙන් බලන්නත් පුළුවන්. කියුමුලේටිව් එහෙම නැත්නම් කම්බයින් ඉන්ටරෙස්ට් රේට් මෙතඩේ ගත්තොත් අද 100ක් තිබ්බොත් අවුරුද්දක් ගියාට පස්සේ ඒකේ වැලියු එක 110 වෙනවා because it's a 10% discounting factor interest rate. එහෙම නැත්නම් අනිත් පැත්තෙන් ගත්තොත් අද මට රුපියල් 100ක් දෙනවා වෙනුවට අවුරුද්දකින් මට 100ක් දෙනකොට ඒ 100 අද වැලියු එක මට එනවා රුපියල් 91. So that both scenario is explainable using this time value concept. So what is this factor? What is this interest rate? So that is basically we talk about cost of capital, required rate of return, discounting factor. There may be so many words that we can use. Basically, it means it's a subjective. It depends on people to people, person to person. How much I need? Maybe somebody would say, my discounting factor, cost of funds, or opportunity cost of funds, maybe 8%, 10%, 12%. So based on that, the value of money, a time value of money will be going to change. Let's say somebody won't say, maybe 15% is my discounting factor, means 100 rupees in year's time is valuable only like 86 rupees today, because it's a high number, highest interest rate that you are expecting. Etan 5% wage kiyala kiwwot maybe it is 93% or 94% or 95% like that. So the equation is you can compute that 1 divided by 1 to the 1 plus r. This is the equation, discounting factor equation. 1 divided by 1 plus r to the power n. R is the interest rate. N is number of years. Like, let's say, take an example. Say, year 0 discounting factor. Year 1 discounting factor. Like that, you can compute so many things, right? If say, year 0 discounting factor, assume r is say 10. What happened? Here 1 divided by 1 plus, what is r? 10% into n is equal to 0. 1 divided by 1 plus 0.1, right, into 1, here 1. Here 2, 1 plus 0.1, with something here 1. Okay, 91, something 0.87. Like that, you can compute. So this is how we try to compute the discounting factor. Means, let's say, if take 100 rupees, 100 into 100, 100 into 100, 91, 87. That's what I was telling you. It's basically, if you know the discounting factor, then if you want to compute the present value, you know, present value is basically is equal to future value into discounting factor. That's what we talk about, right? So here, 100,000 rupees, if you are getting today, value is 100. If you are getting after 1 year, value of 100,000 is 91. If you are getting 100 rupees in 2 years time, value is 87. These are the present values. So our exercise is to see whether value of future cash flows, that is, let's say in the previous example, if say in year four that we are getting something, year two, we are getting something 30,000, means the value of the 30,000 is not exactly the 30,000. 30,000 into this set. 30,000 එකකින් වැඩි කරාම තමයි 30,000 ගේ අද වටිනාකම එන්නේ. Right? So it's like you can, you know, see what are the other numbers also by applying this equation. So depending on the interest rate, depending on the number of years, so we will have different discounting factors. If you know the discounting factors, then we can compute the present value of future cash flows. So under the payback period, we have not done any discounting. We just take each year cash flow and we see whether when I am recovering my initial capital or my capital investment. But here we are not going to do that. Each year you are applying a concept called discounting factor, which is this. So this is going to change based on this interest rate. එක 10 වුණොත් එක, 15 වුණොත් තව එක, 20 වුණොත් තව එක. And then you try to apply this factor against this cash flows, against the relevant cash flows, and see whether what is the present value of that. So when you know the present value of that, then you can say, as per net present value concepts, what is the net present value? Because present value of outgoing cash flows, present value of incoming cash flows, net of that positive is good for me. Negative, not good for me. That is the decision that we are going to take. Right. First, let me know whether you have got this concept before we are trying to do the computation. Sanjeev, Oshani, Dilanj, if depreciation not given straight away, we can divide the accumulated annual profit by 2. Is it right, sir? For ARR, NPV got the concept, right? Not given straight away, we can divide the accumulated annual profit by 2. No, you can't. Because accumulated annual profit, you can't divide by 2 because number of years you need to get. Investment, yes, you can divide by 2, but let's say average profit is being computed, you know, each year profit, you can add up that and divide by particular number of years. In this case, 4, because there are 4 years has been given. But investment, generally we say initial and final, so that's why we generally divide by 2. Ocean, my concept is clear? Dilanja, NPV concept is clear? Right. What about Oshani? What a Teruna. Right. Very good. This is the kind of a concept. Then we move to the question. So then it will be. Right. Right. So how we are going to do the computation is. First, we need to find the discounting factor. Assume that we have found the discounting factors, or examiner sometimes will be given to us. So you have here 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Then we need to know cash outflow, cash inflow, then we have net cash flow. When you are familiarize, you can get straight away come to this net cash flow. Let's say project B. Right? Cash outflow is 100,000. Inflow, just get that. So the cash flow is I have user numbers for you to right. So you have taken here project A, cash outflow and inflow. So you have listed down 100,000 going out, 45, 40, 35 coming in. Special attention here, 30 in plus 20 also in terms of scrap value. So 50 is the cash inflow for year 4. Right? Then what you are going to do is see what is the net cash flow. 100,000, 45, 40, 35, 50. Next important column is the discounting factor at 10%. If you remember, they tell us the discounting factor, cost of capital, required rate of return is 10. So if you know that 10% is there, then using that 1 divided by 1 plus r to the n equation, you can calculate what is year 0 discounting factor, year 1 discounting factor, year 2, year 3, year 4. So now you have this. Then you multiply with this into this. It's the discounted cash flow. Minus 400, multiplying 9, 33, 26.2, 34. And finally you end up with 34.38 positive. So that is using the all cash flows throughout the project period, you have taken discounting factor into the equation consideration, and then you have computed discounted cash flow, that is cash out, cash in. So the difference between, you get a positive number here, which means in overall sense, positive means going out versus coming in is positive, means that you are gaining. Means going out is lesser compared to coming in. If vice versa, if something about minus 10 means going out is higher, coming in is lesser. When we say it's not good as per NPV, but here as per NPV we are getting a positive. Why positive? Going out is lesser compared to coming in. So what's the deciding factor here? No changes here. If this is going to change, make a 10 minute, make a 20 unana, may figure a value. Make a 10 minute, make a 2% unana, may figure a value. Hey. When you are discounting at lower interest rates, you are better. If it's a 10%, na, it's a 20%, na, අවුරුද්දකින් හම්බෙන රුපියල් 100 අද මට වටින්නේ 82. ඒක 2% නම් අවුරුද්දක හම්බෙන එක මට අද 98ක් වටිනවා. So that's how it get changed. So this is the kind of you know, the template that you need to understand. See whether you have got this. Then we can move to the project B. Let me if you don't have anything understood. Sanjeev, Dilanja, Oshani. Thanks, Sanjeev. What about Oshani? Let me know if anything is not clear. I can, you know, explain. Dilanja, come to water. Dilanja, fine. Okay. We'll share the example here. It's something project A. Here, because straight away he has taken net cash flow. Apita take ganna puluwan. But initially we go as cash outflow, cash inflow. Edekin tamai cash net cash flow ekak hoyaganne. Year 0 minus 100, year 1 45, year 2 40, year 3 35, year 4 50. Then discounting factors at 10%. 1.909, 826, 751, 683. So this generally will be given. If not, there may be some discounting tables attached to the past paper. We need to compute using the 1 divided by 1 plus r to the power n. When you know the cash net cash flow, and discounting factor, you just multiply and see what is the discounting cash flow for each year. Year zero, you have 100,000 going out, and all the others you have some, you know, coming in. And end of the tenor, end of the project life, you have plus 34,380. Means NPV is positive, so we are going ahead with the project in terms of A. A kenaka vitarak thibunana. Now there is a project B also. Now for that also we are trying to do a computation and see what is our NPV for the project B. If the project B okay, NPV is you know less or high, we'll tell you which project is good for you to proceed. Go to the project B. Okay, 100,000, 30, 30, 44, and 66 is will be the last one because 46 plus 20 will be the cash inflow for fourth year. And again, using the same discounting factors because at 10%, you have done the same calculation and ultimately answer is 30,000. So based on that, project A is better compared to project B. Right. Any questions? Any questions? We'll be able to manage it, that kind of a question. Obviously, we might do some past papers later, but for the time being, if you have got the concepts, I'm fine with that. Any explanation, any difficulty? Hari, clear. Right. So then we move to the last part, IRR. IRR is again, you try to find a kind of interest rate using this discounted cash flows. Again, NPV came extension. So just give you a better example. It's like this. Let's say you have some discounting factor, rather interest rate. And as against that, you have an NPV here. Right. Now, let's say you have different interest rates like this. A 10% body interest rate. So, there may be some particular rate like 4%, 5%. There may be positive NPV. Then, when you are increasing the interest rates, what happens? This is, will come down, right? Some point, it might say, right? So you have increasing discounting factor, increasing interest rate, NPV coming down. Then up here, 34,000, 30,000. So like that, So, equation. Right. So this is the graphical representation of movement of NPV against the discounting factor in the interest rate. Then there is a point at which NPV becomes zero. At a particular point, NPV is becoming zero. So that point we will call IRR. What is IRR? Is the interest rate, discounting rate at which NPV is going to zero. Simple as that. So we need to find this equation. For that, what we know? For that, we know. Do we know this? Yes. Let's say here, do we know this? That's it. We know NPV1, we know NPV2, we know X1, we know X2. So it's something. Ultimately, what is this? Make a minimum graph. AK, we have two triangles, right? Make a triangle 1 and up to that, make a triangle 2. This is this one. And do we know this? Yes. Do we know this? Yes. Do we know this? Yes. We don't know this part. Make that. If you know this, mega plus mega tamai. That's what we need to come. If we know this, if you go back like our grade 8, 9, 10 meter away, geography, geometric, theorema, ek equation ne karti ho, mainne me wagay, samarupi trikon ke liye, you might have heard this. So x divided by, mainne x2 minus x1. Aline. Make x2, make x1, so x2 minus x1 is this one. So this portion divided by this portion is equal to this. So we'll say NPV1 divided by NPV1 minus NPV2. Then a minus with the one, this becomes plus, but here this is the equation. So x is, and make what is that, is equal to x divided by x2 minus x1 is equal to NPV1 divided by NPV1 minus NPV2. So finally, x is something, x2 minus x1 and then NPV1 minus NPV2 into NPV1. Make the my equation. If you know the x, then IRR is something x1 plus x. See whether you have got this concept clear. I just actually wanted to just I can share the equation, but before showing the equation, I wanted to share the concept behind that. Make a pen la mangitendre anga hituwe. The concept is clear bala. Roshani and Sanjeev, Dilaj. See whether you got this concept clear. First, you need to know what is IRR. IRR is the point where NPV becomes zero. If NPV becomes zero, what we are trying to do here is we need to find this portion. In order to find that portion, we have two triangles. We went back to some kind of childhood geometry, and then we come up with the equation using these two triangles, where this divided by this equal to this divided by this. So hence we have our equation x is equal to x2 minus x1 y NPV minus NPV2 into NPV1 will give you x. If you know the x, then IRR is x1 plus x. You will make a vibhaga tone, but we need that equation for the xr. Ak, you need to know x1, you need to know x2, you need to know NPV1, you need to know NPV2. If you know that four, you can come to the IRR. Right, කියන්න බලන්න පැහැදිලිද? නැත්තම් it's not clear. Is there any? Yes, yes, Sanjeev. Like here, in this case, at 10% we got positive, no? So if you assume something about say 30% or 35%, it could be obviously negative. Why? The main graph figure has to go like this. Higher the discounting factor, when you go to mokada wenne cash flows aduwen thamai discount wenne. That you can't exactly say what is that particular interest rate. It depends on the project to project, but there should be a point eke inda thamai me plus to minus wenas wenne. But the specific point that we need to worry is where NPV is zero. ඒකයි ආර ප්ලස් එකක් හොයාගත්තා මයිනස් එකක් හොයාගත්තා then we apply this equation. Got it Sanjeev? ඔක ඕෂනි දිලාන්ජයි සද්ද නැත්තේ? Let me know if not clear මොකද මේක I know we need to get it very much clear මොකද විභාගෙට මේක ආප ගමන් we need to get full marks you know. Dilanja, fine, very good. Right now, since the concept is clear, we move to the presentation. I'll show you how. Right now, we know that you know two NPVs, two interest rates are required. So, what if you go by this? What they have done is. In a project A, at 10% we got 34,380, right? Because we have computed that. Ita passe, as Sanjeev asked, then we, you know, we need to assume another interest rate where NPV negative, because we need that to put this equation into application. Have I made? Question nikedi when we they think about 25% it's almost negative ne when you apply the 25% these are the discounting factor and then NPV becomes 20 it's something negative means apita kelim mahuna IRR ek so project A IRR is 25 if we are lucky enough otherwise we have to go back and do this computation right so 10% and then we have positive 25% is 20 means almost negative almost zero so IRR for project A is 25 are there then we go to the project B at 10% we have 30,000 at 25 we have minus 7482 etakota we have not got the IRR yet for the project B. Project A, yes, we have got 25. And project B at discounting rate at 25%, project B is something negative, but we are yet to get the IRR, right? So this is how we are trying to compute the IRR for project B, right? Now, if you see this, right. So we'll again move to the question board. Is he understood? Right. Now what happened here? Project B. So we have at 10%, we have 30,172. We have one number. So at 25%, we have minus 7482. So now we know x1 10, x2 25, y1 30,000, y2 minus 7482. Hope it is clear enough for you. What we have done, we at 10% we compute our NPV, we assume another interest rate. So at 25%, we got a minus 7482. Equation again, we have one positive, one negative. Then what we need to know is we will try to apply that into our equation. What is x2? 25. x1? 10. NPV1? 31,72. NPV2 minus 7,482. This is minus minus with plus with. So basically, make the addition. So in other words, change of NPV. Make it to the method difference. X2 minus X1 into NPV1. NPV1 is 30,000. So you just apply that. Api karot. This is 30,000. 172 into 25 minus 10 divided by 30,172 plus the minus minus plus 7482. So this will give you the x square component. Just you add that into the x1. Eka hambuna passe. Eka 12% thara wage no plus 10. So 22 is the IRR for project B. So that's how basically we do our computation. See whether that is clear. Only thing what we have done was we found one interest rate relevant in PV, another interest rate relevant in PV. Most important thing is we need to find one positive NPV and one negative NPV. A hatra dhanagatta gama, we will apply here. X2 minus X1, interest rate difference. NPV minus NPV2, NPV difference. Change of NPV basically. When you say change of NPV, metana minus tiyenisa, metana minus tiyenisa, minus minus plus 1. It's a combination, amalgamation. Addition of NPV, difference of interest rates. So, what is a difference? Make addition maker a theta into NPV1, that is 30,000. So, that chunk will give you the x, this part, plus this one will be your IR. Balan dekha theta nam kiyala. Right, Sanjeev. In that case, what do you mean interest rates not given in the sense? They are maybe first one, anyway, they have to give the discounting rate. So you can double it or triple it. So 10% is the given, you can take 20% or 30%. Higher would be better because anyway, it could be at higher rate, it could be negative. Here they have taken 2.5 times, 10% to 25%. Or if you compare at 10, then you can straight away take 30. Because the 30 bag is the negative when I double or triple. Right. Nilanjan, concept is clear? Oshani. Let me know if it's not clear. Very good. Right. Right, guys. So we have done it. Then what you could do is you can take maybe a couple of past papers, not the immediate version, and maybe previous one or two, and then see whether that you can attempt one or two questions, right? And so that is better so that you can get further familiarized on the NPV concept, because anytime, I mean, every time we see a kind of a question coming from NPV area. Right now, when you have a couple of projects, right? So how are we going to use this tool? If there is a single project, our criteria is payback, less than target period. So I presume that I want to get my money back in 4 years. But if there is a one project which gives me money in 3, I must say it's okay. If more than 4, I said, I don't want. If there's a single project, the multiple project, then we go for the shortest payback. Right? Shortest payback is your decision criteria. ARR above the target rate. So I think I want 10%. I want 15%. That's my required rate of return. My correct judgmental call. So based on that, a target rate, if there's a single project, you go for that. If there is a multiple projects, then you go highest ARR. Obviously, it should be more than your required rate, but I want 10%. And there are a couple of projects gives you 12, 13, 15, 18. You go with the highest ARR because 18 is highest among the rest. NPV, a positive NPV if there is a single project. Multiple projects, we go with the highest NPV. IRR higher than the target rate, cost of capital, because I must say this is, you know, my cost of capital. This is my required rate of return. It wada vadipura denawa nan a project ekak, so you go and invest. Again, multiple projects na, it should be more than, it should be highest IRR number. Okay, so the four methods, one project, multiple projects. So based on that, we'll take our decision. But out of everything, most appropriate, acceptable investment technique is NPV. Irrespective, rest. Others are good, but when it comes to payback, ARR, NPV, IRR, so everything is on board. So your decision is predominantly based on what NPV says to you, right? Then anith ekak udaharanayak gattot api ARR ek project A wala hondai, sorry, project B wala hondai, NPV ek project B wala naraka nan project A th ekka oya ARR ek nevey wage decision criteria ek wenne. Wherever NPV is there, you go by and you go with the NPV decision. So that's it. Basically, the rest you can read out, right? because just to see what's advantages, disadvantages, see it method. That's again good that some kind of advantages and disadvantages of each in case of you need to compare. Other than that, any questions on today's session? Hope that you have get a fair a basic knowledge on each of the four criterias or the investment tools. I know not be very easy sometimes because there may be some different questions has been posed under these four methods, especially in PV and payback are very common in calculation, and IRR also to some extent. ARR I haven't seen but except one occasion, but we need to be ready with all four. Since this time actually the question was most on the NPV, next time obviously we will expect that IRR and payback will be a part of our question, maybe next this coming May or June. So but my advice is, like, since that we have done it, go through and get it cleared. If anything, please let me know next week so that even I will do a kind of a recap, because I think this is important area. And then if you have time, please try to attempt that one or two questions on past papers. Obviously we'll do one or two when we undertake past papers, but rather than waiting for about a month or so, try to do it today, immediately, so that if any gray area comes, so that we can discuss and iron out any issues by next week or week after that. So that's all for today, and if you don't have questions, that we can wind it up. So any questions? Sanjeev, Dilanjan, Oshani, all good, all clear. Then we are reaching very closely for the exams. So maybe after New Year, that we have only 1 month go to, I suppose. So, you need to, select all your subjects and, have your study plan and papers on board. So everything, because I know not very easy these days, everybody like trying very hard on office work. So maybe the same thing could continue time to come also, but hence that don't delay your studies and all that, try to make it, whatever easy things first kind of thing, like, that's what I'm telling, going through past papers this time. I think I have seen, many students have scored very few, like less than 5% is, has not successful. Means that, it's again, we expect the same outcome from you all. So, but don't delay it, as much as possible, try to get whatever your time plan and, complete your studies, since that you might have to do some other exam papers also. So all the best for whatever your studies, and, see you next week or same time. Maybe another 2 weeks time, I might be able to complete the syllabus, and thereafter we'll try to do some past paper questions until New Year or maybe just after New Year. So it's all depend on how you won't make use of that time. So we'll get your feedback also, which area that we are trying to prioritize in past papers, but try to do some work you alone and see whether what are the critical points, and then we will move forward. Again, thank you very much. Have a peaceful and safe week ahead. Okay, take care, guys. Okay.